When most people think about the biology of honeybees, they think about the biology of the individual parts. What do queens do? Workers do? Drones do? What about the swarm? What about thermoregulation? But I believe it's really much more helpful to think about the biology of a honeybee from the perspective of the biology of a honeybee colony. I look at the colony as if it is itself a beast. So what I'd like to do in this video is I want to walk you through the biology of a honeybee colony, essentially a year in the life of a honeybee colony. What does it do from birth to death? In this video, I'm going to try to talk all about that. And I'm going to anthropomorphize honeybee colonies a little bit. You'll hear me saying things like birth, its birthing season, the death, the life, the juvenile stage, etc. But I really think it's helpful to think about colonies in this way. And knowing about the biology of honeybee colonies allows us to be better beekeepers. So let's start where we would start if I were talking with you about a human, and I would talk in that case about the birth of that human. So here I'll start with the birth of a honeybee colony. Honeybee colonies are born as swarms, right? There's a birthing season for honeybee colonies. When nectar flows are just beginning to start, usually in early spring, the colony, the parental colony, is in the process of making new queens. They feel those swarm stimuli that are happening in the environment, and that colony wants to issue a swarm. So the old queen, once she gets down to flying weight, will leave with about 30 to 70% of the bees. They'll all fly around in the air. They'll coalesce on a tree branch or a fence post or something like that. We as beekeepers call that process swarming. From a management perspective, it's a little bit annoying, etc. But from a honeybee colony's perspective, it's what colonies want to do. This is why honeybee colonies live. They live to have a child, and that child is the swarm. So when you are watching a colony swarm, you are watching a colony give birth. So that cluster hanging in that tree branch, looking for a new cavity in which to move, is a baby beehive. It's got all the features of a bee colony, all the potential of a mature honeybee colony, but it's wrapped up into this small cluster of bees hanging from that tree branch. And again, this typically happens early to mid-spring in advance of or during the first few weeks of the major nectar flow, so that that baby beehive now has enough resources available in the environment to move into the cavity, collect a lot of nectar and pollen to build that waxy infrastructure that we know as the comb, to pollen to make into new bees and to feed the young adult bees so that they can produce the brood food that they feed to the larvae. So resources in the environment, nectar, pollen, make it possible for that baby beehive to move into that cavity and begin to grow. So spring, especially early spring, is birthing season in the honeybee world. And from there, once that colony moves into a cavity, it's exponential growth phase. I happen to be the father of four children of my own, and I've watched this with my own kids. They're born and they kind of stay stable for a while, and then they just grow and they grow and they grow. And their growth is resource dependent. The same is true for honeybee colonies. When they move into that cavity, they're trying to time those swarms so that there's maximum resources to put into growth. So in the remaining part of spring, the second half of spring, that colony's building wax, that queen is laying eggs, that colony is bringing in lots of nectar to convert into honey, and they're gaining weight and they're growing to fill the volume of that cavity. And if they've done everything well, but by the time spring is over, that colony is then fully mature, it has reached its peak population, it has stored as much honey as it can, and now it goes into summer trying to be on cruise control. So let's follow then that budding colony, that maximally sized colony that's now going through summer. What are its summer goals? Well, its summer goals really boil down to a few things: disease and pest control, colony homeostasis maintenance, and temperature maintenance. And the last two are intimately linked. So let's talk about the first one first. When honeybee colonies are coming out of spring, they're at maximum population. So over summer, it's natural for colony populations to go down over time. Well, in spring, the colony is outgrowing its disease and pest population, which tend to lag right behind. So in summer, as that population crests and begins to slowly go down, the disease and pest population can continue to go up. And so what you get is you get this intersection between the colony's population going down and then the disease and pest population go up, and you start seeing things tilted in favor of diseases and pests. And I'll use varroa as an example. In spring, colonies are able to outgrow their varroa populations, but in summer and fall, those varroa populations are still going up while the bee populations are going down, and so you get, over time, more varroa per adult bee, and you get these kind of crises moment where colonies are starting to feel the pain of carrying those diseases and pests. Also during summer, colonies are simply trying to maintain homeostasis. It's hot. There usually are not many nectar and pollen resources available in the environment, so that colony turns its attention from gaining weight, bringing in nectar and pollen, producing more bees, and towards maintaining the nest temperature. It's hot, so they have to collect a lot of water to do this. It's all about heat management. So that colony is simply trying not to be taxed in a way that would harm its chances of surviving winter later. So a lot of water collection, a lot of thermoregulation, a lot of fighting diseases and pests. And if the colony's located in a place that has lots of pollen and nectar in summer, then maybe they're also able to maintain their population as resources are available. But as summer ticks by, that colony starts to get a different mindset. And at this point, I liken the honeybee colony almost to a bear. So bears in summer and early fall are just trying to put on weight. They eat as much as they can, try to put on as much fat as they can, so that when they go into winter, they can tap into those fat reserves that help them hibernate and maintain existence throughout winter. Well, think about honeybee colonies similarly. As summer begins to transition into fall, you might get this fall bloom, or you get nectar and pollen available in the environment. And if that happens, and it happens in a lot of temperate areas where honeybees live, then bees put on that last little bit of weight. They're trying to get that last little bit of honey stored so that they can go through the winter months with enough resources available to heat their nest. It's also no surprise that in late summer and early fall is when you tend to get your peak pest population. Small hive beetles tend to be the worst that they're going to be. Varroa are unequivocally the worst that they're going to be. So in late summer, early fall, it's all about stress management. And as they transition into fall, it's all about that final weight gain. Because bee colonies, though they're not technically hibernating, still have a similar pattern through winter. Right? So in fall, they're getting all that last little bit of nectar and pollen. They're making that last little bit of honey. And if they've done their job successfully, they have enough honey available in that nest to go into winter when there are no resources available. That's why honeybees store honey. They're not storing honey for me and you. They're storing honey because honey is the fuel. It's the energy that bees need to survive winter. They not only need it for individual bees to live, but they also need honey to generate the heat that's necessary to keep that colony warm, that critical temperature, so that they can survive winter. Usually about midwinter, the honeybee colony will start tapping into pollen and honey reserves that they have in the nest to start producing that earliest little bit of brood. Back in fall, in most of the temperate world, the queen's egg laying decreases significantly. In early winter, it might cease altogether, depending on how cold it is. So by the time you hit midwinter, you start getting the flip in that scenario. In the womb, as it were, of the honeybee colony, you start getting little bits of brood being produced. So that colony is maintaining its homeostasis through the first half of winter. The second half of winter, they're starting to invest a little bit in brood production so that when winter is coming to a close and nectar and pollen producing plants become available in the environment, the bees are starting to bring in those resources to augment the brood that they are producing in the heart of that nest that may otherwise not look like anything's happening at all. But really what you've got in late winter, early spring, is you've got a pregnant honeybee colony. Their desire in spring, their desire just around the corner, is to give birth to a colony of their own. And in midwinter is when those things are set in place. Brood production, late winter, more brood production. Then you get the appearance of drones in the nest. Then the days are lengthening. Then resources are becoming available. Then congestion happens in the nest. All of these are cues that tell the colony that the conditions are right for us to give birth to our own child. So if that swarm that I introduced you to at the very beginning of this video has progressed through spring, through summer, through fall, and through winter, it is now sexually mature itself and able to have its own child, the next swarm, the next honeybee colony. Really? That's what honeybee colonies are trying to do. I used to tell people that honeybees have two goals in life, to survive winter and to reproduce. In reality, they survive winter to reproduce. So honeybee colonies want to do what other organisms want to do, which is simply have an offspring. So that baby bee colony, as it grows through spring, through summer, starts decreasing in population in fall, goes through a hibernation of sorts in winter, comes out in spring to give birth to its own child. And when that happens, it starts the honeybee life cycle all over again. Now, I'm going to end this video with a small philosophical discussion about the death of honeybee colonies. As beekeepers, we keep thinking we can keep colonies alive into perpetuity. We can manage them into foreverness. They'll always be okay, and we'll be the master beekeepers who can keep these things going. But in reality, we could have a philosophical argument in which I ask the question, when do honeybee colonies actually die? Well, you as a beekeeper might say, Jamie, that's dumb. Of course, they're dead when all the bees in the nest are dead. So that's true from one point of view, but you could also argue that the beast is no longer what it was before the swarm, once it swarms. And what do I mean by that? Well, if it's the old queen who leaves with the swarm, then the parental colony is left to produce a new queen of its own. That means the parental colony that just gave birth to the swarm is now no longer genetically the same as it was before the swarm. The existence of that colony is gone. It's forever changed. Now, you could argue that it actually went with the swarm because the old queen went with the swarm. That could be true, but realistically, that swarm is going to replace its queen probably before next fall. So genetically, the colony that gave birth to the swarm is no longer the same colony any longer. So it's a remarkable life history where you have birthing season and spring, growth and development the rest of spring, stasis or maintenance in summer, preparing for hibernation in fall, hibernating of sorts through winter, coming out into early spring to have children of their own. If we as beekeepers can appreciate the honeybee biology from that perspective, we can time our management to match what honeybee colonies want to do anyway, we'd be better beekeepers and our colonies would be stronger and more productive. But I hope you agree with me that the life history of a honeybee colony is truly fantastic.